Odyssey and actually commented to me that they thought that I shot it on film, which is the greatest compliment I could have ever gotten.
Yeah, excellent. Yeah, is it, by the way, is that film out yet, or?
It's going to be opening across the United States and Canada in November, December, and January. And then worldwide after that, although it is showing in England and France and in South Africa in November and December. And then it'll open up on, well, I don't know, maybe a major distributor will take it up. There's a big chance of that happening. If that happens, then the whole game changes. But if that doesn't happen, it'll be released on DVD in February or March of 2007.
Excellent, excellent. And let's return a little bit later and talk more about that. But I want to get into the Alchemical Cinema, your latest book now. And you mentioned 2001, of course, that movie. But have you, for this book, have you used, have you analyzed a few movies just and kind of use this alchemical filter, so to speak, to analyze different movies? Or how many movies have you been looking at here?
Well, there's probably about 20 films that are mentioned in the book Alchemical Cinema, but it's what I've done is I've taken the alchemy can be broken down into four aspects. Reality can be broken down into four aspects, but alchemy is in many ways a four-part process. And just like there's four brains, and you know there's four letters in the DNA. I took the four levels of the tree of life and the central pillar, and then I used films to evoke each one of these sephira into showing people that each different level of alchemical reality can be unveiled in certain ways, and then I used films, certain films, to show how this is unveiled. And of course, 2001, A Space Odyssey, of which you can read my article, Alchemical Kubrick, on my website. Free of charge, is really, to me, the greatest alchemical film of all time. And I also use Lord of the Rings, both the book and the movie, to show that there is a history going back thousands of years. You may or may not know that Tolkien insisted that Lord of the Rings was the true history of Europe 7,000 years ago. And I try to show that this is exactly right and that it's actually an alchemical history. Tolkien insists that his books are about the closing of what he calls the Third Age and the beginning of the Fourth Age. And that coincides directly with the knowledge from the Cross of Hende, which says that each age is 6,500 years long, and that the end of the Third Age happened 6,500 years ago, exactly when Tolkien dates his books, and that the end of the Fourth Age is at hand right now, and we are in the throes of the death of the Fourth Age, the Age of Iron, the Kali Yuga, depending on what terms you want to use to describe what's happening right now.
Very interesting.
So each of these films tries its best, each of these essays tries its best to show that these films that I'm using in the texture of the book are describing certain alchemical modalities. Even if the filmmakers don't know it, because there's like in alchemy, alchemists believe that there's an overmind or a sphere of influence that surrounds our reality, and that we're constantly being influenced by this invisible sphere of influence. So even if the filmmakers don't know that they're evoking alchemical principles, and in some cases they may not, they still managed to do it, although I do know that Stanley Kubrick was a big fan of alchemy and the Kabbalah, and many, many books in his library were reportedly on alchemy.
Uh-huh.
He had texts by Nicholas Flamel and many others. So I know for sure that he was influenced by it. And then other films that I mentioned besides Lord, and I know that J.R.R. Tolkien, who was an Orthodox Catholic, but I think that it was a strange Catholicism that possibly had been influenced by some alchemical principles, similar to the people who built the Gothic cathedrals.
Mm.
And then the other films that I mentioned are Terminator by James Cameron, which is really about where this age will head if it doesn't end. In other words, if this current age we're in does not end in 2012 or does not end next year or in 10 years, then we probably are going to be heading to some kind of Terminator-type future where the human soul, they will attempt to download the human soul into the machine.
Yeah.
The machine will then become, you know, the device that overruns our world.
Yeah.
Titanic by James Cameron is another essay in the book, and many people don't like the film Titanic, but what is interesting about the film Titanic is that, first off, it's the biggest hit ever in cinema history, and secondly, the film is about us. When you go in to see the film Titanic, you already know how it's going to end. We all know that the Titanic went down on April 14th.
Yeah.
But so the film is saying, okay, what is this about? And the film is how the passengers are on an iron ship sailing in the wilderness, and their own hubris brings the ship down. Their own idea that this is an unsinkable ship, that they can turn all the engines on and go right through a field of icebergs and be, you know, think that they're not going to hit one. And then they hit it, and the iron ship falls apart and they all die. And what's interesting is there's no suspense in this film. We know that that's going to happen.
Yeah.
The minute you sit down in the theater. So it's like an eerie forecasting of how this age is going to end if we're careful. And so there's all these kinds of essays throughout the film, throughout the book, and it's really very exciting to be working on it.
Yeah, very interesting. I mean, there are a bunch of questions that pop up in my head here, but I want to return to the idea of that messages can be communicated through film, yet that the director or the makers of the film might be unaware of it. That is very interesting, I think.
It is very interesting. That comes from letters that I have written to certain filmmakers asking them about their films, and I've received back their responses, and I would be amazed by, excuse this, but how ignorant they were. And then I realized, of course, that this overmind is influencing things, and a lot of people today are conspiracy theorists, and they keep searching for the magic bullet that's going to unveil, you know, the reality of what's going on around us.
Yeah.
And they never seem to find it. And the reason that they never seem to find it is not because there isn't conspiracies. There certainly are conspiracies in this world.
Yeah.
But because there is an overmind that is influencing us in very subtle ways. And this is really the Hermetic tradition. The Hermeticists would influence political events and societal events around them without ever taking credit for it, and no one would actually ever know that it was they, the Hermeticists, who had actually caused the event to happen. This is, of course, the role that Gandalf has in Lord of the Rings.
Yeah.
He is influenced, he's an alchemist, he wears a Phygian hat, and he has a staff, and he rides a white horse, and he is transmuted from Gandalf the Grey to Gandalf the White by falling into the abyss, fire, and all these alchemical allegories are going on. But what he's really doing is he's influencing the events that are occurring, but he's influencing them in a selfless way, not in a selfish way.
Yeah.
So he's kind of the anti-conspiracy theorist. And this is what's going on a lot of levels. You know, people are working towards making a better world every day, and we don't know who they are, and frequently they don't even know that they're doing it. And I think that this is going on, and it's really a cause of great hope,
yeah,
and joy,
yeah,
because there are forces at work that we do not understand. You know, I always like to think about the fact that for 50 years, the Soviet Union, or 45 years, the Soviet Union and the United States faced off each other with literally thousands and thousands of nuclear weapons.
Yeah.
And yet they never managed to get in a war, a full-out shooting war.
Yeah.
I always, you know, thought, why? You know, why didn't a mistake happen? Why didn't, you know, a submarine captain accidentally launch a missile?
Yeah.
And it is quite a miracle to think that we actually didn't destroy ourselves in the Cold War.
Yeah.
And I think that, again, this is some kind of overarching influence of this meta-dimensional overmind that is influencing us and changing us and nurturing us every day. And this experiment, this great alchemical experiment that is us, that is history, is coming to a close here, and the end of the experiment is at hand, and we're seeing it. And this is why there's so much turmoil in the world today, because the people in power don't want the experiment to end because they will lose their power. So this is what's going on, I think, in a very real way, and it's happening in art, and it's happening in science. Like quantum physics is rising up right now, which is an alchemical view
of
science. And this is why you see things that on the internet, for instance, that you wouldn't have never dreamed of even reading about 10, 15 years ago, yet here it is, plain as day, you know, on the internet, and anyone can read it.
Yeah.
So I'm not a Pollyanna-ish person, but I am an optimist, and I do believe that things actually are getting better.
Yeah.
Believe it or not.
Believe it or not, yeah. That's right. I mean, but you think that things are already a done deal, so to speak? I mean, it seems like there are many issues that we have to solve before we can, you know, continue or go into the new, so to speak. But, I mean, do you think that... What is it that we have to do to make this a possibility, or do you think that it is a done deal?
Well, I don't think it's a done deal. I think that we're still at that bifurcated place. We're at that crossroads, and we have to make right decisions and all of that and do the right thing. But, you know, when you boil water, you turn the heat on and the water boils, and the water reaches a state of furious boiling, and then it turns to steam. So its essence is changed at the moment of its greatest chaos, and it's changed into another form, which allows it to escape. Okay,
yeah.
And I think that's what's going on now. We're on the back burner of history, and everything is beginning to boil, and it's about to change into steam, and we're going to escape. It's really the secret of transcendence. We're going to transcend this historical reality, and just as water changes just as boiling water changes from water to steam, pretty much in that instant when the temperature gets high enough, as soon as the temperature of this historical reality gets high enough, we're going to transfer our reality from one to another, and we're all going to kind of look back at what was going on and say, what were we thinking of? Why were we doing that?
Yeah.
Why were we so angry at each other? And we're going to be kind of embarrassed and sheepish about the whole thing. And so, you know, it's not that, it's not